Welcome to my contribution to this year's Michael Kernel Developer Room at FOSDEM. Thanks a lot to Martin Decky and Sebastian Sumpf for organizing this year's Developer Room. So it's a pleasure to be here. So my name is Norman Feske. I'm from the company GenoDevs, the developers behind the Genode OS framework. And this talk will be about the last year's journey to bring together the Genode OS framework and the PinePhone. The talk will be structured in three major sections. The first section will be about the underlying motivation of this work, so why have we even started doing this. The second part will be a bit like a picture story of what happened in the last year, so I can't go into too many technical details, but I will give you some insights into the whole development experience. And finally, I will give you a brief demonstration of how Genode on the PinePhone looks right now. And finally, I will close the talk with an outlook of what to expect in 2022. So when speaking about the motivation of this work, I have to really go back a bit to a kind of root concern of mine, which is basically a struggle that is getting ever stronger, I think, between really powerful dominating corporations and the civil society. And the smartphones and the smartphone industry is, I think, one of the most impressive expressions of this power struggle. So let's take a closer look. So what are the motives behind corporations in general? So don't get me wrong, I'm not anti-corporate. I can understand how this works. But there are still some kind of problem arising from this. So it's natural that companies seek profits. So I'm also running a company, so I know what this is about. So you want to be profitable, and there's also a desire for growth. It's natural for companies. The growth aspect is actually much fueled by investors for the most part, so who demand growing revenue to have their assets increase their values. So what to do about it? Of course, one way is to increase the customer base, and the other way is you also have to keep the existing customers paying. It's clear. And whenever possible, raise the margins. That's basically a credo. and what to do to keep the existing customers paying? It is called customer retention. So one way to do this is to leverage platform effects. So let's say if everyone is on eBay, then all sellers and buyers are going to eBay. So that's basically one thing that that big platform companies strive for. Another one is to create artificial dependencies, so that customers have a really hard time leaving the platform. And another strategy is to increase or introduce new complexity and then offer the aid to make the suffering of the customers less. And so it comes down to making your customers addicted to you, to your products, because addicts are the best customers. And to make this even more efficient, it's always good to have as much information as possible about the customers, the market, the competitors, and so on. So there is a corporate motive to seek holistic knowledge without any bounds. And when it comes to smartphones, it's really easy to see that people are really some kind of addicted to smartphones. The smartphones play an ever more important part of our lives. But smartphones are in need of constant attention by the platform companies, or I would call it medication, because that's the whole story about the security. You have to keep your device updated, you have to keep it healthy, so you have to subscribe to some kind of service from a platform vendor to get new system updates. You have to use the platform provider's competence to save you from bad behaving applications. So there's this whole curation of apps. And you also expect the platform provider to entertain you a bit, like following the latest fashion. So there's a constant stream of new supplies of kind of medication. And yeah, today's situation, two corporations really dominate this whole business. So what about me as a member of the civil society? For a long time, I have really not used a smartphone, and I'm still not a smartphone user, but this is not a long-term sustainable strategy. So I want to participate in digital society, of course. So for example, I want to use a smartphone to look for the timetables for trains, or I want to use a COVID tracking application or things like that. So I'm not opposed to any kind of convenience that a smartphone provides. So I want to actually enjoy this utility value. But at the same time, I value my digital autonomy a lot. So I don't want to subordinate myself to corporate interests. What this breaks down into is that I don't want to have any changes on my devices without my consent. So I don't want to have questions like, do you want to install the update today or tomorrow? That's not a question I want to answer. I want to be in control of the device. I also want to be treated like a human being. So I don't want to be exploited. Like my attention should be mine. I should not be forced to look at advertisements. I don't want to be tracked. I don't want to data mined or anything like that. Finally, I want to keep my communications private by default, unless I decide otherwise. And I want to keep my personal data for me. And another aspect is that I am always looking for sustainable paths in my life. So in one way, that's the environmental footprint I leave. And the other way is that I want to keep learned skills usable. So if I learn how to operate a device, I don't want to learn it again in next years. So there's, of course, a lot of conflicts of interest between those two goals. So first, I think that this whole trend towards subscription-based business models, be it cloud services or this whole security update story, is really a taxation of digital life. And people are slowly getting used to it, and they just transfer money over to corporations in a periodic way. At the same time, data gets more and more centralized into kind of silos controlled by big companies. And those are the same companies who basically look through this data and make out the patterns, analyze this data, or even give this data to third parties without the consent of the end user. So the corporations have been extremely dominant and powerful in these areas. So, and as another kind of aspect to it, because of the whole consumer cycle, that the pressure to always release new electronic products and to have customers buy new versions of the devices, a lot of electronic waste is generated. So these are all political problems, and ultimately, the microkernel dev room is not the right place to solve them. That's clear. But on the other hand, we as technologists, we can at least give politicians some kind of arguments that there may be alternatives paths forward. And this is the whole story about where my motivation comes from. It's not a kind of spleen that I only have for myself. There are a few others who share similar sentiments. So one prominent example is the precursor project by Bunny. It's a kind of extreme approach to a mobile phone that takes open hardware and open software to an extreme. So the hardware is based on a custom SoC built in an FPGA, and the software is completely developed from scratch. The device is deliberately a deviation from smartphones. It's more comparable to a feature phone, which kind of, is a deliberate decision of these developers. But what about smartphones? When looking at smartphones, one project Well, one company really comes to their attention, which is the Pine 64 company that produces the PinePhone. And this PinePhone is marketed as an open source friendly phone, catering to the open source developer community, especially the Linux community. So the device supports the mainline kernel. There are diverse distributions. The SoC is a bit old, but it's well understood and it's quite well documented actually. And the nicest thing is that it's readily available and quite affordable. So it's a good device for tinkering, basically. So that's really attractive. But yeah, open source is not enough. So even if we say, we use a Linux operating system on top of this phone, isn't this all good? No, it's not, because the complexity of this whole software and hardware combination defeats autonomy. So still, when using a Linux system on such a phone, you make yourself dependent on this distribution and you have to be faithful in this software stack that is just incomprehensible complex. So we notice on Linux, for example, I'm using Linux for decades now, and whenever I update my Linux distribution, I think of, hopefully nothing changes too much. And so there is a lot of faith involved, and that's something we cannot overcome really with such complex software stacks. And finally, there is also no queue in sight for this whole security update story. So this is something we have just have to accept. So of course, when looking at a Gnode, this is something that we at least promise to change. So when structuring the system around the idea of the principle of least privilege and sandboxing all tiny operating system and application functionality into small sandboxes, then this whole situation becomes much easier. There is no need to curate applications, or there's also much less need to keep the system medicated all the time. So it's more comparable to kind of cure than the relieving of symptoms. So that's that I think is can be a huge contribution when combined with smartphones. And so I made it my mission to combine Gnode with the PinePhone in the last year. So my aspiration is really to have a replacement for a feature phone, but also so basically featuring telephony, messaging, but also doing being capable of using a web browser and doing encrypted communication, encrypted storage. And also what's important to me is a halfway decent battery life. So currently I'm using a Nokia phone, an old Nokia phone, which has a kind of week of battery life, which is really nice. And I want to have this also in the future. I don't want to address any kind of entertainment or comfort functions. That's currently out of scope. Okay, so how was this whole process about? So how did I start it and what looked at at the different times? So when starting such an ambition, we first have to look into the way of how the operating system boots on a platform. So when the system is powered up, the bootloader takes over control, which is U-boot in our case. Or in the case of the PinePhone, it's a default bootloader. And then this bootloader boots the first ELF image, which is basically a program that runs in physical memory. It's usually called Bootstrap. And then from there on, this Bootstrap program bootstraps the kernel in virtual memory and so on and so on. So the first thing is really jumping from U-boot into a custom piece of program that gives us any kind of life sign. So this is basically the first small challenge to come up with a small program that can be started directly from U-boot and gives us some characters on the serial line. So this is how this looks like. There are a few lines of C code, very simple, directly poking a memory mapped register for outputting some characters, and then a small kind of bunch of instructions to compile the code into an object file loaded that can be loaded directly into the device memory. And you see then the results, and this can make one really happy when this happens, because now we have passed the control to our own code. So the next thing that we aspire to do is to port the kernel, the microkernel. And here the Arduino SoC of the PinePhone is really nice to us because it consists of components that are readily supported by the existing base HW kernel of the GnodeOS framework. So it's a pretty aged by now 64-bit ARM SoC. It uses the standard ARM GIG version 2 interrupt controller, generic timer infrastructure, very simple UART interface, and of course a custom memory layout that needs to be configured. But all in all, it comes down to basically mirroring the platform support for an existing SoC, so for example the IMX8, and adjusting these files for the PinePhone, like picking the right interrupt controller and setting up the physical memory layout. And this basically takes, I would say, a week or so. This is not a big challenge. But the biggest challenges are ahead of us. So the next small exercise to get the toes wet with the hardware is to access some kind of device hardware. So the first tempting thing to do is to run some kind of GPIO controls on the chip, so to toggle some pin state or to sense some pin state. And so for this, a small test program can be written that uses Gnode's basic services like IRQ and MMIO to access memory mapped registers and receive interrupts. And this is really fun because this draws the connection between the physical world, like we have here a pin that goes into the SoC, a physical thing that has some, that is basically a wire, and it goes into the SoC. Then it goes through a bunch of logic, and then there is some device inside the SoC that maps this to a bus that's on the system bus, which then can be accessed by the software here. And the same thing for the interrupts. So this is interesting how this physical pin is basically wired up to the interrupt controller and then ending up in the microkernel's IRQ handler to the user application. So the nice thing about this step is that it really lets you see the physical effects of some piece of software, which is quite nice. So now the next thing when having this basic test running was to bring a bit order in this whole situation. So instead of allowing this program to access all the hardware, we introduced a platform driver that basically assigns a certain specific memory mapped I/O ranges and interrupt numbers to this specific program. So there's a kind of access control enforced by the platform driver. And as another step, we go further. We put this or change this program into a proper driver with a driver interface that allows other programs to control individual pins. So, and here what we here see is the strength of a microkernel-based system. We have a cascade of authorities that can limit the reach of the programs. So here at the bottom we have the kernel and the core component of Gnode with ultimate authority over the whole platform. Then in the next step we have the platform driver, which has handed over all the memory mapped I/O resources and interrupts, so it has authority over all devices. But then it gives only a part of this authority over to this GPIO driver over here. And this again can assign a part of its own authority to a simple program. And so the actual program, like this LED pulse program here, can access only one specific pin in a specific mode, which really comes down to the principle of least privilege. The experimentation setup looks like this. So you can have some wires here, some resistors and an LED, and can play with it. And this is all a lot of fun. And by the way, this board, what you see here, is this Pine A64 LTS board, which mirrors basically the PinePhone hardware and is also available at the Pine64 store. Yeah, so the next step up is the problem of dealing with real devices, not just fiddling with some GPIO pins, but some real drivers. So when looking at real hardware, real drivers, you see that on ARM SoCs, The situation is much more chaotic and less regular than on PC hardware, which basically is organized around the PCI bus. On ARM SoCs, it's more chaotic, and you have to you are faced with a lot of complex interplays between device details like the power regulators, clocks, reset lines, a variety of buses, and many, many quirky details. And added to that, there are certain pin functions that can be selected for the SoC, which adds another level of obscurity, I would say. But it's, of course, it's a nice feature of these chips, but it doesn't make the situation any easier. And on top of that, the documentation is often not available or quite sparse. So the only reliable reference to working systems is really the Linux kernel, because the SoC vendors are usually the ones who write drivers directly for the Linux kernel. And so we are now faced with a situation where we can look at the device trees that are shipped with the Linux kernels as some kind of hardware documentation. And the cool thing about this is that this documentation is really the ground truth, because it's actually kind of executed. So if there was a mistake in the device tree, then this Linux kernel would not work on this hardware. So that's quite nice. It gives us a lot of information about the hardware. We also found that because of this whole interplay between the different devices and the clocks, resets, and so on, that the porting of the drivers is much more feasible than the developing of the drivers from scratch. So we concentrated completely on this idea of porting complex device drivers from Linux to Gnode. So when starting this kind of idea, it's useful to start with a reasonably small example, like an Ethernet driver, and we will come to bigger or more complex devices later. So when looking at Ethernet and looking at the device tree for the Pine A64 board, yeah, it looks a bit like this. This is a graph visualization of the device tree. It's basically incomprehensible. So to make some sense out of this, we came up with some custom tooling that processes this device tree files, and where we can say we are interested in a specific part of the hardware, in this case the Ethernet controller, and want to only retain things that are related to this part of the hardware. And here the tool spits out this smaller device tree, which is in itself consistent, but consists only of the parts that are relevant for networking. And this becomes suddenly much more clear and can guide our way for porting code from Linux. Yeah, speaking about porting code from Linux, one intermediate step I always did is basically first trying to build a custom Linux kernel that is as bare bones as possible and only drives the hardware that I'm after. So in the current case, a Linux kernel that drives the network but does nothing else really. So, and the usual process is to start with a tiny config of the Linux kernel, which is basically a Linux kernel that doesn't work really. So it's really it compiles but it doesn't run, and then try to find the configuration values for the Linux kernel that produce a kernel that performs a bit of network functionality, like issuing a DHCP request. And to aid this process, we can look into the device tree, find information there about certain compilation units. From this compilation units, we can learn config options that are conditions for this compilation units. So we can add these configuration options. We can also let our intuition guide us. So for example, it is logical that the Ethernet controller also needs a foo driver, so things like that. And also, of course, some kind of rational thinking. But in the end, there's a gap here in the middle where we can't really guess what kernel configurations options are needed. And for this, I came up with some kind of sledgehammer approach, basically bisecting the configurations of Linux to try out the minimal set of configurations. So each of these config options you see here required several kernel compiles and boots of the kernel on the platform, but in the, so it took maybe a day or maybe even 2 days to find out these options. It's quite a boring task, but it's terminating the process. It's terminating, and it leads us to this kind of minimalism, which is really nice. Because in the end, when we have this kind of small set of kernel options, we have a really tight Linux kernel that we can work with. And then it's time to transplant code from Linux to the Gnode system inside, put it into a component. And here we came up with a new version of Linux device driver environment, which allows us to use unmodified Linux kernel code here and combine this with a small kind of emulation environment of certain Linux kernel mechanisms like memory subsystem and init call handling and things like that. Then a small API layer for certain Gnode interfaces that map the C++ interface of Gnode to C interfaces. And then finally, we have the Gnode API. So on top, we can use the services then of the driver, and on the bottom, we can access the device. And so this is a very rigid scheme. So for example, we keep really C++ and C galvanically separated. So next thing is, so basically to wrap this up, once I got the network driver working, I switched my attention to the PinePhone as a development platform because that's my actual goal. And so I looked about the process, how can I work with the PinePhone. The cool thing is it can boot directly from the SD card, so you cannot really break anything or brick anything. You can always swap out an SD card and start from new, which is really nice. It's also cool that you can basically repurpose the audio jack to become a zero line by just flipping a small switch. And there is an accessible reset button, which is really cool. For the workflow, some things should be considered. So for example, SD card juggling is not really convenient when you look at these kind of Linux bisecting experiments. You need to boot the system like hundreds of times, and juggling an SD card each time is not viable. So other strategies are needed, and we can of course also not use Ethernet, so TFTP is out of question. So I looked at U-Boot's fastboot support, also with the help of an old friend, Ivan Loskutov, who gave me some really, really valuable hints. And so I could automate much of the workflow and also combine this with some custom automation tools in Gnode's toolchain. And as a small detail, there are these tiny things. So for example, you have this reset button in the back of the phone here. This is a small hole. So you are supposed to fiddle with a small toothpick or so in this hole to reset the phone. But when developing, for example, a touchscreen driver, you have to flip the phone for each test, which is really not convenient. So I came up with this small life hack here. So I had a small screw laying around, and by putting the screw inside the hole and flipping off the phone, the whole phone becomes a big reset button, which is really nice and extremely satisfying. So these are the small things that make life so much better. Yeah, now looking at the display driver, you see again this kind of part of the device tree that is concerned with the display. You see that's a lot more complicated than the Ethernet part. So yeah, there's lots of questions and to answer. So the process of cutting down Linux is more or less a mechanical work. It came really down to this small set of configuration options here. So, and this is actually enough to bring up this crippled kind of version of the Linux kernel, which basically just presents us tux and then it crashes maybe, but it doesn't matter because it has successfully initialized the frame buffer, and that's what we wanted. So that's really nice. And so we can go on and select the driver sources that we find in the object files and look at them, consider them to include into our component, then compile and link the result. And if we see any unresolved symbols, we can generate dummy functions for these symbols automatically using custom tools that we developed over the last year. And yeah, and when such a function is called, we look closely to this to the called function, supplement custom emulation code, and try it again. And this is basically an iterative process that basically eventually leads us to this result. So a working graphics driver, which is extremely satisfying. So don't get me wrong, it's not all roses. It basically takes sometimes a really long time to come up with this, but there is a very structured way of doing this. So now we have this frame buffer driver running on the platform, and when we can really see all the kind of devices that are accessed by this monolithic frame buffer driver, and this is really staggering. It also expresses how big intertwined to all the different driver parts of this SoCs, ARM SoCs are. So the problem arises that when we try to add another driver. So for example, besides the frame buffer driver, we want to also have a touchscreen driver. So, and here suddenly we see a big conflicts. So that the same drivers want to access the same hardware resources, and this is of course not possible or not getting any useful results. So now we have to start the process of basically cutting those dependencies here and basically either adding emulation code in here in the drivers or putting in intermediate components that basically reconcile the access of those devices. So this is how it looks like in the end. So basically everything that's related to clocks, power and reset is basically put into a different driver component, and both drivers access this higher level driver component, and all things that are related to general purpose IO pins are basically going through this component over here. And now we have nicely reconciled those both drivers on the platform. So this is really the whole microkernel idea here. We know exactly which parts of the SoCs are accessed by which driver, and so we can also assess the reach of the driver on the system. Yeah, that's really intuitive now. Okay, so now that I have covered these kind of small story about how the process went, let me give you a short demonstration. So as you may have guessed, I'm actually using Gnode right now. So this is basically a script-based system here. So this is my slide program here. And here I have a normal Linux, an Xubuntu Linux running inside a VirtualBox. And the whole system runs on top of the Nova hypervisor. And in this terminal up here, I have connected this to the serial line of the PinePhone. And over here I have a build directory for Gnode or for ARM V8. And now to give you the look on the PinePhone, I will basically start a component to look at our webcam. So I will just deploy a small program here that basically captures the picture from the webcam and displays this in a window. And you can see here that this window appears here, so we can see the phone. So some dust. Okay. Now I can issue the command to. So the phone is actually already switched on. So you see the red cable here. It's so the phone is powered. It's currently stuck in the U-boot bootloader, and it's waiting for a fast boot command. So here I can give it the command to basically run this sculpt test run script. That's basically part of the Gnode tooling, targeting the base HW kernel, the board PinePhone, and also direct the log output to the core component of Gnode. So let's give it a try. So now there's not much to build. So we just integrate the image. And in this case, the image contains also some kind of pre-loaded software, so it's a bit larger than normal. So this takes a few seconds until the image is generated, but not too long after, we should see here that the system is booting up, and on a webcam you will briefly see, here it is. You can see that the user interface has been started. So you see now the same script OS that I'm running on this machine. So basically, when I go back here, you see the same kind of system that I'm having on my machine here. The same system basically runs now on the PinePhone, except for some details like no persistent storage. But for example, I can basically click on this or touch on these different user interface elements, and the user interface responds to this. So for example, when I touch this settings bar, you see you can basically change also some user interface settings. And one specific interesting thing is that I can deploy some scenario from memory. So I can use the RAMFS. So you cannot really see it, but I can tell you that now the system is deploying a Gnode subsystem as a deployment. And here you see that some components have been loaded. I can switch to this kind of desktop by pressing it to the side here. And you see here there is a small keyboard here and a terminal over here. So I can basically, and there's actually a window manager running. So this is of course still inherited from the desktop version of Sculpt. And I can even drag these windows around and use this small keyboard. Okay, it's hard to see in the webcam, but I can basically type in a small command. So for example, I can type in something like ls and return, and you see that this Linux, not Linux, but it's a native Gnode based Unix environment. It's basically presenting some results, and I even can in principle also use things like Vim to edit all kinds of files on the system, and so for example also access the configuration file system of the Sculpt OS. So basically, this gives me a whole complete control over the device. Oh, let me see. Q. Okay. There's also a small demo I can show you. That's basically this rotating. Oh, maybe I haven't. Yeah, I failed to reach it here. I still have to train my fingers to type on this touch screen. So here a small program is coming up that basically, you may recognize this from previous talks. That's basically a small software rendering demo running now directly also on the Sculpt OS. And the nice thing here is that all the underlying infrastructure, like the package management concept, the deployment concept, the configuration concept, etc., it's all the same things, the same components as we use on the normal Sculpt system on PCs. Okay, so that's basically what I can show you right now. So now to close the talk, let's give some ideas what's next. So the vision for this year is to have a video chat scenario running on the PinePhone. So I want to chat with my family, for example, using this device, using Gnode and Sculpt. And there are, of course, a lot of challenges on the way. So these are just an enumeration of things we have to work on, which is at the same time exciting but also a bit frightening, of course, but it's we are really driven towards this goal. If you want to follow the progress of this ambition, you are invited to visit the Gnodians website, which is basically a kind of blog of various Gnode developers, and I'm publishing an article series called PinePhone, where I report on the progress that I make. And in the end, this article series will be integrated into a large document that's called the Gnode Porting Guide or Gnode Platforms document, which will give a kind of guidance to future developers who want to bring Gnode to other SoCs. So, for example, if any one of you is interested in the new PinePhone Pro that is based on the Rockchip SoC, then this documentation is probably the best pathway to develop this kind of support. So there's already the first version of this document online, but it will be updated in May with the new findings. Okay, thank you very much for your attention, and that is the end of my talk. Thank you.
So let's start with some questions. There are some questions in the chat. You or the others have partially answered them, but maybe we can just repeat them for the stream. So there was one question about the base HW. So could you just tell us what that actually is?
Yeah, sure. First, thank you for organizing the Dev Room together with Sebastian this year. So, about the strange name of this kernel. So, it's really the result of this naming scheme of Gnode. So, Gnode OS framework supports quite a few different kernels. So, you can use the Gnode OS framework on top of traditional L4 microkernels, or also on the Nova kernel, or the SEL4 kernel, or the Fiasco OC kernel, and also on the Linux kernel. And at one time, 7 years ago, we had the idea to come up with a custom microkernel that is actually much simpler than compared with the traditional kernels. So it has a kind of different software architecture that is glued more closely to Gnode. And by doing this, we expected to reduce the complexity of the base system even further. So we already had a pretty good or a pretty tight base system with the existing kernels, but we saw the potential that we could reduce it further. And so we came up with the base HW kernel. And the notion is that now Gnode runs on the real hardware, not with a kernel underneath, but the Gnode's low-level system is touching the CPU hardware directly. And so it's called base, not base minus Linux or base minus Nova, but base minus HW, which means it accesses the hardware directly. But it's still a microkernel. Yeah.
And in practical terms, it's your native microkernel.
Yes.
That really fits your architecture perfectly.
Exactly, yes.
Okay. Then there was a small question, maybe just a clarification. So the demo you have shown, that was really running just on the phone. There was nothing running on the desktop machine.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. So maybe the demo where I executed first Gnode on the machine, on the laptop, and then on the phone, well, it's a bit misguiding. But yeah, the phone has a complete separate system running, and it's loaded as a single image through the fast boot channel to the phone. And then executed standalone, so it's running autonomously on the phone. Yes,
wonderful. Another quick question: do you plan to support the PinePhone Pro as well in the future?
So not immediately. So the idea. So I have to come back a bit. The one idea behind this work is that the idea was to go through the process of porting all these difficult technical challenges, but not only doing this, but also documenting all these steps in very much detail. So the idea was to, at the end of the whole process, there should be something like a book. I would say it will be like 300 pages or so, that explains in detail how this kind of process works. And so I hope, that's at least in my hope, that others will find this kind of idea inspiring, that now someone else can also take this book and take a new hardware and apply the steps of this book to get Gnode running on this new hardware. So that's my goal, to cultivate some kind of community around this idea. And so I put a lot of work into this documentation. So I would say more work was spent on the writing the documentation than on the actual technical work. And so I think that it would excite us very much if someone else would step up and take over this idea to bring Gnode on the Rockchip, for example, which is the chip used in the PinePhone Pro. and we would give assistance, of course, but the kind of the ownership of this project would be somewhere else. But anyway, if there's some, for example, commercial interest in that, and someone would approach us, then of course we would be up to it to do this. Yes.
Okay.
But, another point is I think that the PinePhone is appealing because it's a limited platform. It's universally known to be not really strong. It's a bit dated. And if you look at the Linux systems on top of this platform, they do not perform really so well. So it's usable. Don't get me wrong. I admire what's happening in this community, but it's not comparable to the user experience that we see on commercial phones or on consumer devices. And I think if we manage to really rock the phone with Gnode to bring a really nice user experience to the phone, it also would nicely allow people to compare the beauty of microkernel-based systems and the performance of our system to Linux to basically dispel the myth that microkernel systems are slow. So if it performs better on the phone than Linux, then I think that would be quite exciting. But I cannot promise this, but that's my goal.
Yes, it definitely sounds very, very, very intriguing, I should say. And going back to the UI, there was a question in the chat as well in that direction. So clearly, the desk, quote unquote, desktop UI is really not a good fit for this, you know, touch screen, small touch screen. So do you have any ideas or plans towards having really a smartphone native, you know, touch screen native UI?
Yeah, so there are several ideas. I think it will be two staged. So there is a one stage where we have some basic interaction that gives the user control over the phone, but not much convenience. So that's basically what this user interface that you see right now presents. It's very small in terms of bytes. So it's the image is very tight and very small. It boots up quite quickly. And then there will be a second layer on top of that where everything is basically up to the different use cases. And for example, I think that it would be really nice to bring Qt-based applications to this phone on top of Gnode. So for example, there is the Sailfish OS that uses Qt for applications. And so the applications on this phone, on this OS, are really native applications using QML and all the kind of beauty of this, what you expect. And there's nothing that would speak against leveraging these kind of frameworks like QML on top of Gnode, and that's what you would then present to the end user, of course. But in the intermediate step, of course, we need to have some nice ways to interact with the phone as a developer. And so here, our kind of intermediate components like this touch screen keyboard come into play. I think nobody really will enjoy this, but it will have its purpose for our development and for hacking when playing with the device, playing with the power management, with the modem, and all these kind of things.
Okay. There are several more questions, but sadly the time is running out. So to prevent your answer being cut off, I would like to thank you again for this amazing talk. And we are definitely looking forward to further development in this area and in Gnode in general. I encourage our attendees to ask you more questions in the chat. And thanks once again. See you. Bye-bye. Cool.
Yeah, thank you.